Welcome to the Lucha Lounge. I'm your host, Steve DeMarco. Hope everybody's enjoying whatever day of fun that they may be having or are set to have. If you're planning a fun day in the future, I hope you enjoy it. I know that I'm trying to enjoy mine. Just in case you haven't heard, which means you probably haven't caught the last couple of episodes. If you have, then you already know what I'm going to bring up. Reality Wrestling's next television taping, which is taking place May 14th. If you need further details, feel free to go to realitywrestling.com or download the app, the Reality Wrestling app. And be sure, if you haven't already, check out our show when it airs on CW39 at 11 a.m. on Sundays, or you could always go to our YouTube channel or go to realitywrestling.com and catch the latest episode. And they've been jam-packed with quite the bit of action. So everybody's really, I think, hitting their stride, and I'm eager to see what the future holds for Reality Wrestling. But speaking of Reality Wrestling, my guest this week is the current television champion. He dethroned Brian Keith, who was on a historic 13-month title run with the television title, and the man that took it from him. I think he broke Brian Keith, and that's Rex Andrews, who I've had on the show before. So if you haven't checked it out yet, go to my YouTube channel and be sure to check out my conversation with Rex Andrews when he was Sergey Volkov. So he's now going by Rex Andrews. We kind of discuss that, the name change, and his maturity as a performer. He's grown by leaps and bounds, and he was really on top of his game when I first saw him. I've always thought he was one hell of a talent. I think he's really finding his voice, and it's a process, and I think he's embracing that process, and at times that's all you need. But he's a hell of a performer, and I think he's been putting on some great matches, some real blur the lines believability. I mean, that's it's good and brutal what I see from him. But really enjoy his work, and it was really good to sit down with him. I got to talk to him about some of the stuff that Gustavo and I had discussed. Hopefully you caught our last episode. Speaking of Gustavo, you caught me and Gustavo geeking out, or me geeking out with Gustavo over the upcoming films that we both like to watch, and we were getting into a pretty good conversation, and then my camera ran out of memory. I have just so much internal memory, and I found out what I finally hit the limit. I've never done it before, so trying to take precautions moving forward. Not really sure, I'm going to take precautions so that it never happens again, whether I just have to, have an alarm when it's set to go off. And I've been pretty good about gauging the length of time, but I miscalculated when we started recording. So yeah, I cut off, and we were really into a pretty good conversation. But anyway, but Rex and I discussed his time in the ring with Gustavo Mendoza. We also talk about going to India, that opportunity, how that came about, and some of his thoughts and views on that. Then we discuss returning and being a guy who comes back to a company, and kind of the maturity where he's at now as Rex Andrews, and what he's hoping to accomplish is being the television champion. He's been dominant. I've been really impressed with what I've seen, some of the matchups that have already aired, as well as some of the stuff that will be airing here in the near future. It's some good stuff. And of course, this was filmed a little bit before, about a week before Texas City WrestleFest. So appreciate all those that came out to check that show out, or make the fantasy camp that following Sunday. But again, that won't be the last fantasy camp, so be on the lookout for that. If you haven't, again, whether you're a you're new to the industry, you're a fan, and you're wanting to see if this is something that you'd like to pursue, or, you know, it's always been your life's goal to get into the ring, or you're an established, you know, been other places and just want to get a look at the facility and kind of see what reality wrestling has to offer, then that would be your opportunity. So back to, Rex and I, we discuss India, we discuss coming back, we discuss a little bit about movies, but you know, he's really into his training and whatnot. But we talked, you know, a couple of things back and forth, talk about some of the current product, what we've seen, what we like, what we don't like, you know, just kind of a, it was a good, fun little conversation with Rex. Again, I have a tremendous amount of respect for what he is, what he does in the ring. I'm a fan of his work, so it was great to get to sit down with him. And now next week, as of today, what I have set, I'm actually getting my buddy Yule, otherwise known as Killer Cash. He and I have kind of gone back and forth about having him on my show. The opportunity arose. He reached out to me. I think we were talking a little bit, catching up, and he's like, man, I should really be on the show. And I was like, why not? So... So I'm looking forward to it because he's opinionated, and you know, sometimes that brings out the more opinionated side of me. But it should be a fun conversation. That'll hopefully be aired next week. Again, get the opportunity to come check us out. Go to realitywrestling.com to get more details about when and where, because I'm thinking we'll be venturing out. Texas City WrestleFest won't be the last time we'll be on the road. But again, you know, our home at World Gym Arena. I couldn't ask for a better facility and a better group of people to work for and work with. You know, just happy to be part of it. So, as I always like to say, stay cool, stay sexy, stay classy. But you will be all those for sure, definitely, without question, if you sit back and relax and enjoy my sit-down conversation with one of the most dangerous men in all of reality of wrestling. I mean, he brings the real to it, I gotta say. Big fan, the one and only, the current television champion, Rex Andrews. Until the next time, later! Rex Andrews!
Steve DeMarco.
Oh my god. Now, you know what? The first thing. The Lucha Lounge. But the first thing, because I listened to the last conversation, and you were Sergey at that point. We talked about how they came up with the name, and Book was like, come up with a name because no one will get their ass kicked by a guy named Rex.
And then you don't get to pick the name. This is your name.
And you fast forward almost 18 months later, roughly, and Rex Andrews kicking everyone's ass. I mean, literally, not just figuratively, you are whooping these guys. But we'll get into it.
I'm getting some kind of reputation here.
No, buddy, be very scared if you're facing me. This guy's crossed the ring. He looks real nice. He's real got calm demeanor. Not Chris Russo probably wouldn't say so, but we'll
probably not. Probably not. Chris
Russo. He gets a
great guy though.
Great guy. So last time we spoke, you're still Sergey,
right? Yeah.
And then Team International was doing their thing, and then it just kind of, I guess maybe without Gustavo, like without a, like everybody trying to kind of vie. I think it was almost like who's the leader this week kind of deal.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it was a great run, right? We accomplished everything that we could at that point.
Yeah.
And it was at a point where, like, we didn't have any stars, you know, like a big babyface star. You gotta have that, right?
Yeah.
And so we couldn't keep being the focal point of the show for sure.
No, because there were points where it was just you guys.
The whole...
Like, it would be episodes. Yeah. Like, it was almost a joke of... Count the episodes that you're not on.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, especially those that, like, you go back and it's all team, because y'all were breaking the feed, like, right, it was just...
Guys were just trying to get on, like, one show a month.
And yeah.
Like, oh, I got a promo this week.
It's like, I don't even want to be there.
Yeah,
what?
Yeah, we're out, you know, we're doing something every show, and it's great, yeah, but it definitely, I think, come to the point where we were ready to move on. Like, Aiden had evolved as a performer a lot.
Yeah.
I know, I had, at least in, like, technical ability, like in the ring kind of sense, and I definitely needed to progress further, but I don't think I could have within the restraints of the team.
Okay. But back to what you were saying. So yeah, they kind of, you guys are kind of, I guess, because once you achieve that, there's really no, where else can you go? I mean, exactly, you could have remained this dominant force, and again, no one else is getting on the shows. You probably have locker room morale at an all-time low. No, but then you admit it, like all of you evolved had, again, Reina wanted to be in the forefront, mm-hmm. you know, and then you get Parviz for, you know, for a time, which, man, yeah.
Interesting. A lot of interesting concepts and a lot of things, but I think you could definitely do a lot more with this separately than you could with us together. I mean, and they did for a long time, like X and Parviz doing their own thing, mm-hmm. which is a really interesting way to use Parviz. And then, you know, Aiden and myself going off and having like a little feud and things. I think it was for the best for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Now, we go back to that conversation you're having with Book where Rex Andrews, not a Bible name, even though it's your name. Had two different Facebook accounts at that point. What was the discussion to have you go from being Sergey mm-hmm. and not just break away from the team, but now becoming Rex Andrews?
So the discussion was pretty simple, like, you know, come up with a name for who you are, and I was like, well, kind of just myself, you know, and like how it's so hard to just with an alias for who you are, right?
Yeah.
I'm like, I am who I am, so like it fits me because it is me, you know what
I mean? Yeah.
The conversation was really, you know, we can't really come up with anything better. Rex works. Rex is it's a cool name. And Book just was like, Rex is fine.
Okay.
What happened to that? You know, why was I Russian?
Yeah.
But I think it was like this transition. Book sees things a certain way, and he's going to continue seeing it a certain way until a drastic change happens.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, he'll have like you know, just certain opinions on things until something comes along and changes it. So I think in his eyes, I was at the level I was at until a drastic change happened with the character to move me forward.
And plus, I think as opposed to probably when you came in, he's like, well, you're not a proven commodity yet. Let's give you something. But then once he could see, well, man, on his own, I think we could... Well, we've got to eliminate that. And like, let him be him. I think he's, you know, kind of in a way like, you've earned being being yourself, as opposed to, I'm going to make you a certain role to play. Now you get to be yourself. You spoke of you and Aiden. What was that, for you, what was that feud like? I mean, how did you feel about it? Because you guys had evolved, but being teammates and then becoming, you know, in essence, adversaries.
Yeah, I think, I really respect Aiden. Work, absolutely, mm-hmm. and I think we had very both aggressive styles. I think we meshed well. I think it could have been a lot better. I think we could have told a lot better of a story, but I wasn't prepared to play the role that I was playing.
Mm-hmm.
It was my first experience in this babyface role. It was my transitioning back into not being Sergey Volkov. Okay, so now I'm Rex Andrews. Now how do I get people to understand who I am? How do I differentiate myself from who I was.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying to find myself, and I'm like, you know, I'm focusing on all the wrong things as opposed to just, you know, having a good match and telling a good story mm-hmm. with a very credible opponent.
Yeah.
So I don't think I did him justice in that feud, but I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed working with him.
Mm-hmm. So, not shortly thereafter, but, you know, Gustavo had been exiled, mm-hmm. and then he comes back, and not only does he come back, but you're the guy that he... pinpointed. I mean, not just from a storyline standpoint, but in a lot of ways, you're the reason he even wanted to get back into the ring to begin with. Because I remember talking to him, you know, that conversation I had with him, where he was just like, "No, I don't have any other stories to tell." And it's like, wow, well, that's, I envied that, because it's always like, oh, well, there's always a story to tell. Like, there's always something, especially on the medium that we have.
Right.
But for him to go, well, I want to come back specifically because of Rex. Now, how did you feel about being, you know, pointed out from a guy who is so highly respected, not just within the locker room, but I mean, Book holds Gustavo in such high esteem by, you know, definitely he's earned it. But what was it like for you to know that you're the reason that he returned?
I mean, it was, you know, it was an honor, honestly. He's a very good friend of mine, and when I first came here, he was my first friend in Houston, you know, the first guy that I could, you know, took the time to, you know, invite me out when, you know, I was in Houston. I didn't know anyone. I'm just here to train to wrestle, and, you know, he he's sticking around with me. Like, try this. Why don't we do this? You know. And without Gustavo, I definitely wouldn't have achieved what I have achieved, for sure. Mm-hmm. So for him to say, you know, we never had this opportunity to work together in a, you know, against each other and tell a story, and for him to want to come back to do that, I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah.
And I know he did it, at least in part, because he saw that I was having a hard time getting into this role, and I was having a hard time finding my stride.
Yeah.
And having a credible heel opponent, having someone who knows how to tell those stories and is thinking in the right mindset to go against, you know, it did wonders for me.
Yeah. So that led to first ever, probably will probably never be duplicated.
Probably
this
not.
This well, because we won from an aesthetic, from a practical standpoint, we're not in that building anymore. I mean, that was part of the appeal of that match, and I know it had gone through the brainstorming of that idea of what to come up with. The thing initially was going to be like, oh, an empty arena match, and then it was like, no, well, let's kind of make it kind of like a fight club, you know, like a high-end fight club. With Book watching on high and whatnot. But as I talked to Gustavo last week, he had mentioned, you know, because the interesting part about that match was the fact that initially it was going to be a one-fall match. It's kind of what you guys had prepared for when you went out there. And then the audible got called right after what would in essence be the first of a best of three. Now I've gotten Gustavo's opinion of that, and I'll be honest, I've never put anyone through that. I called audibles for specific reasons, but it's more like take it home early, or we're gonna flip a title, but the guy losing the title knows it. But I've never had a, well, let's just add a couple, let's add time. I've always subtracted time, never added time
after
or fall.
Match.
After, as, yeah, you guys, you know, and like I mentioned Gustavo, the mindset is, oh, well, we'll go through this match, we're gonna have a great one fall match, we'll probably expend all our energy. You're in a very hot environment with lights. I mean, it's probably like 130 degrees in that building.
Yeah.
It's like hot August. I can't remember what time of the month or year is, but I'm sure it was just blazing. Yeah, so it's just like blazing hot. What was when you get told we're gonna go a little extra? What were you thinking? Because Gustavo's like, I didn't have anything at that.
Yeah, so I'm laying on the ground, you know, I'm staring up and just huffing and puffing, and I hear this match is two out of terrible Booker, but two out of three falls. I'm like, oh. Okay, so like I roll up and I'm thinking, you know, like, okay, so what do we do? You know, we haven't had any time, opportunity to talk about this or think about this. I know Gustavo mentioned when you guys were talking that I was just on him.
Yeah.
So I was like, you know, from my standpoint, like, I'm up a fall. This is two out of three falls, and like, he's down in the corner. Like, I gotta take advantage.
Yeah,
of this.
I mean, if he, why not? I mean, get it. You hear two out of three, let's end it quickly. So,
Yeah, so I remember, you know, jumping on him, boom, 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 and, you know, just kind of struggling our way into a couple more falls, and I know Goose was struggling, but you know, I don't think he did as bad as he thought he did. You know what I mean? Like he's so hard on himself, but like we working through that, I wouldn't have been able to get through that alone.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, like I know I was like, you know, all right, let's do this, let's go for this, and like he was able to keep us like on a viable line there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, as opposed to like if you had someone who. Because it's like human nature to like panic, almost like be like, oh, what, to, you know, and have someone who's taking, like you both kind of took a breath in the midst of it and like, all right, buddy, we'll
make it there.
We'll make it there.
Yeah.
And what I want, you know, it's strange that he hadn't seen it. I mean, I rarely see, would watch my stuff usually, but because again, we're all probably our harshest critics. But honestly, I watched that and I would tell anyone to watch it only because I thought the match was good. It told a great story. I thought it was a great conclusion, I guess, to what you guys had built, you know, that feud. And the fact that you had to call it on the fly, I was like, man, that's, I don't know if I don't know if really anyone who would, you know, and not panic and it be noticeable. Like, even if it never made it in post, even if there was that point of like, all right, we need to take a minute to converse or there was no time, you know. You guys were, you know, that's not like a something that was fixed in post, that was just real time as you were.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm a little disappointed in it. Just, I guess, if we had known beforehand, we would have been able to tell that story a little bit better.
Yeah, no, kind of ebb and flow it a little bit, make it a little more dramatic. Absolutely, or whatever. Yeah. Or just, again, getting the second chance to cap off that story. Now, so the ramifications were that you were told to, you were kind of in exile for a bit. Yeah, because the company couldn't deal with you two. It kind of almost happened between you and Abe. Like, it gets to this point where Booker may have to step in and be like, guys, we can't have this. same thing with you and Gustavo. But coincidentally, once that door kind of closes for the most part, you have the opportunity to go to India.
Right,
and you and I have talked a little bit about it. You know, give as much, you know, as far as like, how were you approached about it? Mm-hmm. So how were you approached about it initially?
Initially, it was just, you know, we heard the Great Khali was opening a school, mm-hmm. and they were just kind of putting out feelers like, you know, we're looking for applicants to see who would be the best fit to go do this. And like you said, like, I was put in exile, I didn't have anything to do, and I'm like, you know, an opportunity to go live in India. I'm a naive kid who doesn't realize what the world's like, so let me go check this out.
Yeah.
So, you know, I applied or whatever, I met with Khali, and that's pretty much it, man. Like, I remember just like 2 weeks later, I had an Indian visa, and I was like, I guess I'm going to India.
Wow.
Which, yeah, some kind of like Indian mafia stuff. No, he's good.
We got
he's got the application. So, yeah, I moved over there the end of May, and I was there until about August. I was supposed to stay for 4 months. Unfortunately, my father passed away, so I had to come back.
Oh man,
it happens, right? But it was an amazing experience. Like, just the how their culture is like, and what's cool is, you know, I'm going into this place. These guys, I've had zero wrestling training.
Yeah,
they kind of knew how to take like a lofty bump, mm-hmm. and things like that. So I'm coming in, and, you know, I'm teaching them from square one, and 40% of them speak English.
Okay.
And about 20% of that 40%, about 50% of that 40% pretended to speak English.
Nice.
You understand what we're doing?
Yeah.
And like, no idea what's going on. It's like, okay. So I mean, it was a struggle. It was very challenging for me as a coach. I like to teach. I like to help people through things, but I don't think I'm the best at, I don't have the best patience in the world.
Yeah.
So that was very, very challenging. But just the level of respect these guys have, and the approach of, you know, just treating you with like the utmost respect. Like, I was treated like, like we would treat Booker like every time you go, and it was amazing. And they knew like nothing about wrestling. You know, I mean, I would, like, just tell me like one match in like history. Who's your favorite wrestler? No idea. Like, what do you want to do in wrestling? Go to WWF. Like,
oh.
Okay. We're a little dated. We got some problems here. But yeah, it was
really like that Hulk Hogan guy.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I remember one of them told me his favorite was Batista. And I was like, okay, well, why Batista? He's like, it's a good body. I like his body. Hey, there you go. Okay, so, you know, but it was very interesting, man. It was really cool to be able to try to teach these guys something,
mm-hmm.
And try to just, I had to explain to some of them that wrestling wasn't a fight, you know? Like,
yeah.
This is performance, this is an art. I had to try to teach them, you know, like, why to do things and how to do things and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was an incredible experience for sure.
So you mentioned the culture shock. Like, for you, exceeded your expectations as far as, like, 100%. You kind of Americanized, you're used to the Western 100%. Way of life, plumbing, all of that. Mm-hmm. What's it like over there, you know?
So I remember getting off the plane and just like walking outside, and this is New Delhi, and just like the smell of the city hitting me in the face. And, like, it's just
Jarring,
yes.
Yeah.
It's not something you'd find here. And I can't explain it. You know, it's not like it's just like, oh, this is not good. Like, it's not being taken care of.
Yeah.
And, you know, they pick me up, and we drive, and we had to drive to, like, the northeast corner, north, west corners of by Pakistan.
Okay.
Yeah. And we're going, and like the first thing I see is like this like 12-year-old girl by herself on a like an overpass underneath, or yeah, underneath an overpass, mm-hmm. and she's laying out a blanket, and it's like 12 o'clock at night. She's all by herself. Man.
Wow.
This is rough. Yeah. So you see that, you see like tons of poverty, tons of people, you know, homeless. And like, there's a lot of these things that are it's like these homes made out of like sticks and like a tarp, like black tarp, and right beside the road.
Uh-huh.
So like people are living in this, and not to say that it's all over the place, but you know, there's a lot of poverty, just, I don't know, it gives you like an appreciation for things, you know, mm-hmm. like I remember, you know, like there's AC nowhere, you know.
So, yeah.
It's like 113 degree wind chill at like 10 o'clock at night. I was like, oh,
wow.
This is great.
Wow.
So, I mean, these guys are, you know, wrestling 8 hours a day, mm-hmm. 115 degrees, no kind of air conditioning. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you don't have like a lot of poverty, a lot of struggles for them that we don't have here, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of things to take for granted, for mm-hmm. sure.
Now, like food-wise, like how hard was it to maintain any semblance of?
Yeah.
Was it hard? Like, you know, I mean, you weren't malnourished or?
No. I lost a lot of weight though.
Okay.
Just
sweating.
Options-wise, yeah, and just burning a lot of calories.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, our kitchen was like a mini fridge and like a burner.
Okay.
Like hooked up to like gas, right? So mm-hmm. like everything's boiled in a pot. So I had 16 eggs a day, something like that.
Okay.
Eggs, beans, rice, and like chapati, which is like their wheat flour, and pretty much like every day. Sometimes I'd have like okra, things like that, but yeah, I'm just surviving off eggs. And like sometimes you get a chicken,
mm-hmm.
and it's weird, because like a chicken is like the size of one breast here. You know what I mean? Like a whole chicken.
Yeah, yeah.
And here we have like these monsters.
Yeah, we have like, definitely good. Like something fishy going on with our stuff. But
yeah, I got food poisoning over there. I had to go to the hospital.
Wow.
Yeah, because so we're in Punjab, which is with no beef mm-hmm. whatsoever. Like some parts of the country you can get beef, and I tried it. I don't know if it was beef. but so we're in Punjab, and like a guy's like, Coach, do you like burgers? Yeah, do you want a burger? So I have a lot of questions about this burger. for like, what kind of meat's on this burger? Like, what do you put on a Punjabi burger?
Yeah.
You know, so we get one from a roadside stand. I don't see, you know, any kind of refrigeration going on or whatever.
Okay.
But, you know, I'm like, hey, they're doing something, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ignorant, right? I'm just like, sure, let's go for it. So I get this burger.
You're like, burger?
Come on, man. I'm tired of eggs. So eat the burger. Yeah, I ended up in the hospital like a day later. It was like just the most wrecked food poisoning you can imagine, you know.
Oof.
But it's to be expected.
So as far as like the training, like for you, I mean, you're, you know, kind of hitting your stride to some degree at ROW, and then you're going to India and you're having to train everyone from scratch. And
right.
I mean, I've done that a few times, and it, you have to have a certain, at least in this, even in this day and age, you have to have a certain level of patience to even want to be that,
yeah.
You know.
Put a translator in the mix.
Yeah, and try the language barrier, and then people that, at least here you have people that have some semblance of an idea of what wrestling is,
or at
least what's current. They're not saying WWF as opposed to, you know,
that base knowledge, and trying to, like, just smash you. Yeah. Hold on a second.
Hold on. It's not. How did that? Do you feel that helped you develop, or you know, as you're training them, did that help you in any way, shape, or form? You know, just.
Yeah, I think. Just you know, the more that you observe the basics, I think you're more aware of like what's good and what's not, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, was a problem I had with Kali a lot was like, you know, run this spot or whatever, they do like a couple moves. I'm like, okay, so you can't do this because this doesn't really make sense. We gotta do it this way. And then he's like, you know, that's too much. You can't go that far with him. And that's, you know, completely valid. That's probably a little too advanced for people who like don't even have a base knowledge of trying to explain the wins and whys.
The psychology of, especially when they're just the mechanics. Like, he's like, let's just make sure they can do it without
right,
killing each other.
Yeah, but then I'm like, this you know, that leads on a bad path.
Yeah, yeah.
Just teach move.
Yeah.
So yeah, you know, trying to do that, it definitely made me more aware of things. I think, like, where I really made gains was just having the ability to just be in, like, my own head and kind of think. And like I said, I was focused on the wrong things before. You know, like, you get this idea of, like, of what doing well is, or, like, what is a good match, or, like, what is it that makes me, like, good or different or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, you know, everyone... You know, like, everyone's focused on the moves, or everyone's focused on...
No, it comes with time.
Yeah.
Like, realizing... Because when you're young, you're going, well, I don't want to go slow. I want to do everything that I possibly can, because in my mind, the cooler stuff that I do, mm-hmm. the more of a response I'll get.
Right, yeah.
Unless you're working with, like, a very old-school crowd that don't have any grasp of what you're doing, and then you're like, okay, well, what really works?
Right.
Like, now I tell everyone, like, don't worry about the moves. I can give you plenty of situations and characters that completely did it how people would say, don't do that,
right, yeah.
and they're getting away with it, and then some.
Because it fits, like, them as a
character.
It fits
their character,
yeah,
or
yeah.
if it's the story of whatever you like, and now it's like trying to, you know, my position is trying to tell people, like, don't just worry about the story. Like,
yeah.
what is Book ultimately, like, what does he see? Because
yeah.
don't ask him about what a finish is unless he's asking you. Ask him more about, okay, what really is the purpose?
Right. Yeah.
And the only reason I bring that up is because recently Jonathan Vega and Brian Keith had a match, like, mm-hmm. right before you came out. Well, no, actually, that was the match that you came out,
yeah.
which we'll get into in a minute.
Yeah.
But I remember going, telling both of them, like, especially Vega, going, look, man, you know, embrace whatever they give you, and they wanted to kind of change what he was. And I said, Brian, you maybe go to bat for him, and you guys have a match. You
right.
know, just
yeah,
a
yeah.
good, like, a match that will, you're both friends, like, you can kind of tell that story. Maybe we could do some backstage stuff. Maybe we can do, you know, kind of like a little package, whatever. And I said, and I just kind of put it in their mind. But when it came the night, it was like, Book goes, well, this is what I want. This is
yeah.
the story I had. So I had to go back to them and go, understand, Book, this is the story.
Right.
And so I used that, like, moving forward, going, everyone, mm-hmm. go find out what the story is.
Right.
And go find out from Book. Don't, everyone else mm-hmm. only has a kind of an idea. But ultimately, Book knows what he wants, what
right.
he doesn't want. This is his toy chest for all intents and purposes, so go to him, you
yeah.
know, and ask him specifically, like,
right.
not really sure. And then when guys don't ask him, they're just more like, well, what would be a really cool spot? I'm like, it doesn't,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
so it's good that you see it that way. But it is it probably frustrating now. You hear those conversations,
mm-hmm.
or even think back, like, I would think back to stuff that I used to do and go,
why
would I do that? Like, what was I think? Oh, man, that was totally wrong, you know, or like going, or having an appreciation for it, because, like, oh, well, without knowing, I was kind of getting.
You can get away from that. I'm my own worst critic, because if you're just being analytical about, like, that move looked bad, I could have done this better.
Yeah.
Like, you can tear anything apart, but if you're like, no, the story was there.
We got,
you know, we got where we needed to go.
Yeah.
You can appreciate that a little more.
So you come back. And then you're kind of brought back into the fold.
Mm-hmm.
But it's different. I've watched you, I mean, we had that match early on when you were just, like, Sergey was
yeah.
a thing, but you'd been...
Never got my rematch.
Never got your rematch. And I don't work there anymore. And, you know, as far as people know, I'm, I'm undefeated against Rex Andrews!
But
yeah, it was Hurricane. When I was battling food poisoning. I know, I was.
Yeah.
I remember telling you, like, hey, man, I don't.
You were like, we're going to take it easy.
We're gonna just have a good, fun match, because we're not even in the
yeah,
mode.
Yeah.
So let's
it wasn't
just
even about me. It was like, I think Robbie came out.
Yeah. But, so I've seen you. Like, the Sergey stuff, I think it was, you're trying to find your way.
Yeah.
And then you become Rex. You know, you kind of earn, you want to be a babyface, but you really... trying to figure it out.
See, I think that was the problem. I was trying to be a babyface. I wasn't trying to be a character.
You weren't trying to be Rex Andrews, irregardless, yeah. You know, which, but I see you now, and it is a, you were always good. From a technical standpoint, man, I, you know, you were, I remember listening to our stuff back then, and Buck always thinking you're one of the top guys. I mean, obviously you went, you would represent ROW to some degree, you know, whenever we would go out, and then you come back and it's like, you're still, but you've evolved. Like you, how do you feel you're doing as a performer now? How do you feel?
I feel much better for sure. You know, yeah. I definitely feel like I'm not where I want to be. Absolutely.
Okay.
Like I feel like I'm still kind of evolving this character and still kind of just going through iterations of it, right? Just mm-hmm. developing it out, but of like just feeling that, and I think that's, you know, where the stiffness or the, you know, it, like it feels like a fight when you're doing stuff like that. It's like that's what I need. Like,
yeah.
I need to have that.
And by no way, I mean, like, me and Gustavo talked about it, you've heard, you know, and I've told other people, like, even the fact, like, new guys, like, oh man, you,
I know,
I'm you picked the,
like,
but the truth is, I would put it like this, there's nothing wrong with being the guy that, where they feel like they have to be on their game.
Yeah.
Like.
Because I need that, you know.
Yeah, I'd rather them be nervous, like, partially fearful. Because honestly, if I were to face, say, Gino,
yeah.
completely on a different spectrum, you know, as far as, you know, what he does in there, and it's not taken away, like, what he does is amazing.
Yeah,
but it's a completely different vibe. Mm-hmm. With you, it'd be, all right, I need to make sure my win's good, mm-hmm. make sure I don't let him, you know, almost like legitimate, like,
yeah,
make sure he doesn't get behind me. Cause he can put me out quick.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, the intensity, like, I don't see it as a bad thing. I mean, there are certain promotions that I would work for. I was that guy because that's the respect I demanded for what we were doing, or
right.
what we're doing. Like I never like people thinking, it's a night off. Or, you know, I like people that value working with me, but at the same time, there would be instances, where, especially if I was holding a belt and it was like the main guy, I wanted people to be like, okay, everything else on the card, that was all a show, but when he's out there, and that's, I think it's the ultimate compliment to you, because
you.
When you're out there, I don't feel it's a show.
Yeah.
And for me, in it, when I'm watching it, you know, when I'm watching back on post, or like, I know there have been instances, you know, where I've had the opportunity to kind of just walk around in the back of the arena just to kind of see how the crowd's reacting, and the, like, the hush of, this guy's going to mess up whoever. And I mean, you've had some great stuff. I mean, I think the talent level and the execution's really increased from everyone. But,
absolutely.
Man, you are really, man, just elevating your game. Now, obviously, you... we've talked promos. You're still trying to figure out that portion.
Yeah. This is like, again, just like developing out the emotional spectrum of like who this character is, and like, you know, what is the what's the motivations, right? That's what it all boils down to. But you know, the more I'm out there, and the more opportunity I have to be this character, the more it fleshes out. Like I feel like with Brian, it was a culmination of everything.
Yeah.
You know, that match, I'm very proud of that match. It was a lot of fun. And that's kind of like why this is continued. I'm like, I'm not stopping here.
Yeah.
I need this back.
Yes.
We got to have it.
Yeah. Well, like, you know, let's talk about before that, earning the opportunity. You're thrown into a four-way ladder match.
Yeah.
That had kind of gone through a few changes as far as who the guys are. Like the day of, it was
obvious
just kind of
choice.
You want to know? Yeah. Let's have no time to think about this. It's 6:30. It's you four in a ladder match.
Yeah, sure.
For a ladder match for you, like what was going through your head just from because they're different kinds of matches. They're not. You're more. Most of the stuff that you've done has been just a very technical. I mean. When Gustavo came back, there was the street fight.
Yeah.
But the ladder matches just kind of, we don't do them very often.
Right.
Because Book's not necessarily a guy that wants to see that all the time. Yeah.
Train wreck, yeah.
But yeah, what was going through your head for during that ladder match?
Just to keep the realism of it, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, like, it's like very like utilitarian in that match.
Yeah.
I'm only touching this ladder when necessary, mm-hmm. and the way I'm going to use it, I'm just going to throw it at people's faces.
Yeah.
That's it. That's all. I'm not going to set up some contraption and fall off of it.
You're not worried about the moment. You're just no, this is a practical
ladder,
thing.
Face.
Ring, that's an actual weapon I can use, so yeah.
And this, you know, I love that match too, just for the finish of it, was just I had the opportunity to just put the ladder up, walk up, and then just leave.
Yeah.
Like, just so anticlimactic. And they're like, well, we wanted to see, like, crazy stuff.
Yeah.
Nope. That's not what you get from me.
so then, yes, that led to you going after Brian. Mm-hmm. How do you feel, you know, Brian, another guy that's kind of synonymous with the brand.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about facing a guy like Brian?
So it was like an interesting choice, right, because I had number one contendership as an option. I could go for like Gino or Brian. They're both, you know, amazingly talented, but I think as a performer, Brian is top tier.
Yeah.
You know, he's fantastic. Like, he walks out and everyone knows that he's a star.
Yeah.
He's got, you know, this very interesting way to move, and like just the way that he wrestles is fantastic. I just thought he had gotten complacent in his role.
Yeah.
He had gotten settled, and he had like little stuff with Gustavo here, like, you know, six man tags and stuff, but he hadn't really had like a challenge recently,
mm-hmm.
that would, you know, he was on his toes, sitting back a little bit.
Yeah.
So like, I took advantage of it.
And you were, you know, former internet champion, former television champion before, you know, before that.
Television, yeah.
Yeah, you were like the first, like, when they made the, yeah.
I messed up a couple of promos with that.
And I mean, at that point, you were doing, like, open challenges to guys, wrestling multiple times on a taping. It was like, you know, unheard of. You were pulling, like, double or triple duty.
Yeah,
it
looks like we're bringing in this guy.
Yeah.
You're going to fight him and fight to it.
Whatever. when you finally win the match, and then one of your challengers recently was Aiden Christiana.
Yeah, yeah.
And now again, you both have evolved even further since,
right.
you know, almost 2 years,
right.
2 years ago. What was it like to get back in the ring with Aiden?
It was a lot of fun. You know, just had the script flipped, kind of, you know.
Where, yeah. Yeah, because last time he was more of the villain in the
the
scenario.
Yeah. So it was, you know, really it was a challenging match, just because I think Aiden is trying to find this role at the time of, like, you know, trying to get that crowd sympathy and trying to get, like, you know, finding his spot there, and I'm the new champion, you know, kind of setting my role. It was an interesting match. But, you know, I think we worked together well. I think we ended up telling the story and just allowing me to kind of further develop out, like, what is this reign going to be for me?
Yeah.
You know?
So are there any guys that you currently see on the product, either guys that you have faced or guys that you haven't faced, that you know, because you kind of throw it out there, you'll take on whoever, whenever, you don't really care. It's all, you know, just be prepared. Whoever wants to face you,
right.
Be prepared for what's coming. You
absolutely.
Know, it's more like a handshake. Gotta do what I gotta do. You know, no apologies necessary. You just give them that firm handshake. Be like, well, I'll see you out there.
Yeah,
but are there any talent out there that you currently see that you're that you wouldn't mind facing?
Yeah, I wouldn't mind facing anyone. Honestly, you know, it's I think our roster is the best it's ever been. 100%. Everyone's very interesting, and I wish I could work with them, but I don't think it's going to work out. Ministers of Defense is probably my favorite character on the show.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, fantastic. But the obvious answer would be Gino, for sure. Yeah, with him being champion, and I just feel like his character and my character are just anti, you know, just...
Yeah,
like,
yeah, he's, you know, a lot of the Flash, you're pretty no-nonsense. I mean, you both get the job done, both have stellar... you know, his stuff's just... art in one facet, especially depending on who he's facing.
Mm-hmm.
Yours, dude, the brutality that I see. I mean, again, it for me to be like, wow, I don't. Did so and so say something to him? Like, there were points with Aiden where it's like,
we've had sponsors coming to the back and say, like, is he okay?
which is great, you know. It's just kind of, I mean, in the fact that you are no nonsense. You win and you just go to the back. But and Gino, again, just all the pomp and circumstance, very grandiose. I'd be interested in the promos alone, because or if you ever just interrupted him or whoever. Now, before we started filming, we both, I mean, we watch the product. We watch anything that's out there. Yeah. I mean,
wrestling fans, right?
I watch what, you know, I specifically have DirecTV, and I added every channel just so I could get to see any wrestling that, you know, Lucha Underground, get to watch it. Yeah. And that blows my mind just from character standpoint. Like, I learned so much just from a character standpoint, and the idea of, like, just trying to be different in this, can't be WWE, so don't try, be like, this is your own world, and they're expanding as they go, which is really
interesting. That, like, it seems like taking, like, the live show aspect of it, not, I mean, it's still there, but it's kind of, like, removed in that, like, you know, you watch Monday Night Raw, and it's catered to the thousands of people there.
The social media, like, footprint, footprint that's there for WWE, as far as from everyone's kind of, it's this quasi-reality era that they're doing, where
he tweeted this in the back, now he's,
or then they throw in the Total Divas, you know, the vignette from it, or whatever, and something carries, or, like, they're breaking ground, like, they're like, look, this is what we're doing. And it's all encompassing, and it's great, and it's brilliant, but it is a very hard to grasp how...
It's our universe.
Yeah, just huge. Whereas Lucha Underground is created, you know, now they're kind of expanding to a city. Before it was the temple, and now, like, but that the fact that there are luchadors that run around and that they get into bar fights and
it's like, this is for you when you turn the TV on.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Just like, this is what it is.
Don't worry about what they're doing outside of this. Don't follow them on Twitter. I there's part of me that likes that. You know, like, I know it's Ricochet, you know, but honestly, I didn't realize it was Ricochet until someone told me, because I was like, oh, I like the Prince Puma guy. I hadn't seen Ricochet's work until, I didn't even know it was Matt Cross, Son of Havoc was Matt Cross. At first, I thought it was Delirious for him because of the beard, and I was like, well, maybe they brought him in, but I didn't realize it was Matt Cross. And then someone told me, and I went, well, I like the Son of Havoc guy. That's a guy who was on Tough Enough, was told, like, be a character, find your character, stand out, and now you look at him.
And everyone on that show looks like a star. Everyone's
everybody's different. Everyone's got their role to fill. Everyone plays their roles, you know. But we talked about NXT, and we talked about Nakamura and Zayn from TakeOver Dallas, which I've seen maybe 3 or 4 times.
Me too, yeah.
Angle Michaels from, I want to say WrestleMania 21, used to be my go-to. Used to be like, if I'm having a bad day, or I go, the wrestling business sucks, I go, well, let me watch that, all is right with the world.
Right.
From a wrestling standpoint, or Michaels and Undertaker from 25, where it's just like, oh my god. But I've never heard a Fight Forever chant. I've never heard that in all the Japan shows I've seen, all the Ring of Honor shows. Like, I've never heard that specific chant. And there was something about that match that was just, and you had mentioned it too, that it was just, I don't know, flipped a switch.
Yeah, absolutely. I was looking at wrestling from a different perspective, and I've watched Nakamura in Japan, and I've seen Sami Zayn's work, and they're both amazing. But when you watch that match and you know all the variables, and you know this is his first time at NXT and it's a whole different world, and Nakamura comes out and he just grabs everyone. You don't need to be a wrestling fan. He walks out and you're like, oh, what is this? And it's just, you know, it's mind blowing. And then from there, they don't let you down. You know, like, they're coming from, they have a lot of things going against them. You know, they're babyface. They're Nakamura's never been here before. It's WrestleMania weekend. All this, you know, crazy matches all night. But just, you tell your story, and they told an amazing one. And they didn't do much, but I think, like, Fight Forever, I don't think it'll ever mean as much. You know what I mean? Because
I think if you ever do it again, like, if I ever hear it on a Raw, and it's not a Nakamura, like, AJ, you know, something where it's like the equivalent of that.
Yeah.
Although with the NXT I don't know if it would work on a Raw, because unless it's like the night after and you have a Mania or something like that, because maybe it's that kind of audience or depending on where they're at. Mm-hmm. But
it's like you watched like Styles versus Zayn from a couple weeks ago.
Yeah,
and it was an amazing match.
Yeah,
but like just not the same. The crowd isn't.
Yeah, they just didn't seem to gravitate towards it, and you kind of go.
It's a different audience.
Yeah, it's a completely different audience.
Yeah, yeah.
Who else do you like? Do you like to see? I mean, we talked about more just in the main, like overall main products.
What I've been watching right now is 2002 Triple H,
who's
the best.
Oh my God! Just
I think versus Spike Dudley. Was like this match is amazing.
Yeah.
What is going on?
Yeah.
That was a great time for wrestling.
Well, like him and Taka Michinoku, like it was. I remember it was a Raw where I think Vince was like, oh, "You're gonna have to start at the bottom," and that was like his first opponent.
Yeah.
And he made Taka. I don't think Taka's ever looked as good.
Yeah.
And it was just such a testament to Hunter. Like people can say what they want about him, you know, like you read dirt sheets, people can, at this point now, they're like, oh, thank you for NXT, yeah. But back then, they were like, screw you,
and occupying the whole show.
You're why are you on every segment, and why you gotta marry the boss's daughter, and all that, but yeah, so anyone else that you're currently seeing, that, or?
The show's so good, you know,
yeah.
Like, wrestling's, like, it's a great time for wrestling,
yeah.
You know? As a standout, just that grabs. I don't know. Do you have anybody you're grabbing to right now? Tag team wrestling.
I mean, Gable and Jordan to me is a revelation.
Yeah.
Just from what two amateur wrestlers can do in the confines, just how they. No one's got a better hot tag than Jordan at this point. And just and like their takeover match. With the camera work, the way that Jordan tags Gable or Gable tags Jordan. Jordan like just runs around the ring, and then next thing you know, like he's not in camera shot. Next thing you know, he's in camera shot with like the spear in the corner. Nakamura, of course. I think I watch a lot of his New Japan stuff because you know I've got Access TV, so I'm getting to watch like that run as he regains the Intercontinental like right to you know.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get to see, like, the Wrestle Kingdom match with Styles and kind of knowing that that's it.
Yeah.
You know, like, now he'll be at NXT.
Speaking of Kenny Omega.
Omega's amazing, man. Like, and what I find even more amazing with him is the character portion, like, because of what New Japan does where they do the, you know, they have the guy at the beginning of the show that they're going to ask him about matches, which I think is a great... Like, oh man, we should do that. Just
right.
Like, yeah, 6 months later, let's revisit this, or even the post-match press conferences, but where they had him on one, he's one of the few few foreigners that they would have on the show, talk about his match, and he's totally just in character.
Yeah,
like, Stardust for me is like the equivalent. Like,
yeah.
Never fought. I remember Stardust being on Book's radio show and being Stardust and not letting Book go, well, Cody, and he's like,
that's not me.
So, like, stuff like that. Bayley, all the women, but Bayley, because I remember seeing her when she really started to get her shine, where she would come in and big hug, and she was just like the ultimate fan. I'm like, man, that's no one's doing that.
Right.
So her, I love seeing Styles because I've known Styles 16 years.
Yeah.
So getting to watch. Again, it's just such a different time. Like,
absolutely.
It's such a weird, where guys are now getting to keep their name. Like, they make a name. Like,
it's
I hear
like
Eric Young just, Eric Young just debuted, and he's Eric Young. Samoa Joe debuted, and he's Samoa Joe. Mm-hmm. Styles gets to get to the main roster, and he's AJ Styles. Like, he's not repackaged. It's
like we're back to the territory days.
Yeah.
So, like, you go make a name, and then, you know, aspiring pro wrestlers have been to do extra work and things like that. Like,
yeah.
You just go out and become somebody, you know, get a following. Like, Kevin Owens is Kevin Steen, right?
Yeah.
Just, you know, like,
he's another one, like, I didn't see a lot of his Ring of Honor stuff. I'd see highlights. And I was even, when I heard he got signed, it was...
Everyone was
But he had me his first NXT promo where it was just something different. Like,
right.
they didn't... He wasn't trying to be a character. He was just living and breathing in it. At least
it wasn't wrestling promo.
No, it was, which I think is just the way it's, at least for them, that the, that system. It's like
being
the best version of you that you can possibly be. You know,
I think ideally that's the industry right now.
Yeah,
it's just like, you know, we're turning into like, you know, just like every other TV show, just more dramatic, more realistic, more. Realism, and I think that's why I like tag team wrestling so much. It's like, that's the one place where you can just be like over the top goofy. And
yeah,
this works. You know?
Yeah, like, well, like Enzo and Kaz,
yeah.
Like, I'm a big fan of theirs. I mean, again, I mentioned, you know, once the bell rings, there are times where I'm like, Kaz, I know he's kind of a can't miss prospect size, you can't teach that, all that.
Yeah, yeah.
And Enzo's just a great ball of energy, but I'm They're sometimes there's little disconnects here and there,
right.
But again, the personality, I can't I like the vaudevillains, like the
team, yeah. But like vaudevillains, like one guy walks out, does that gimmick, you're like,
even Gable and Jordan, I think,
right.
Without the, you know, Jordan great by himself, Gable probably great by himself, but they're phenomenal as a team.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, man. And then just like what the Young Bucks are doing, you know, in Japan or Ring of Honor, I mean, like, the I think overall it's just a great time to
it's an opportunity for everyone to be as diverse as, like, you know, it's like the old days of, like, I remember, like, hearing Raven say, I have this character, I need TV, I need to make, to figure out how to be Raven.
Yeah.
So he goes to ECW because they had syndicated TV or whatever.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, it blows up. But, like, that's everywhere now. Like,
yeah.
You know, you can go and, like, we're at reality wrestling, we have TV, and, like, you know, I have this character, I need time to develop, and this is an opportunity to do it, you know. And then, like, you know, everywhere is just, it's opportunity. Like, there's a place for every style of wrestling, and it's available for everyone.
You know? Yeah,
it's amazing. Yeah.
So speaking of fun times to be a fan.
Yeah.
You're a big comic book movie.
Yeah, I am. I'm not. I wouldn't say fanatic.
Okay.
Yeah, I definitely keep up with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I enjoy it.
Did you catch Deadpool by any chance? Adrian may be coming over here later. Don't let him know.
Buddy.
Oh, man, I can't believe you haven't seen it yet.
We're going to go see it right now. I'm in the theater.
Have you seen any of the big stuff yet, or is there anything that you're really looking forward to seeing?
Civil War, for sure.
Okay.
I've read the book. You know, it's a lot of fun. Behind on movies, man. What do you think of The Amazing Spider-Man?
I mean, for me, it's all like, and it's strange to say it because we're talking comic books,
yeah.
But if there's a certain level of authenticity to it, like if they're going to make Spider-Man into a teenage Peter Parker,
right.
Let it be a teenage Peter Parker. Like, let it be, like, whoever's playing him, like the kid.
Yeah.
Let him look like a kid.
Okay.
So that when he wears a suit, you have... That's the big thing. Like, he doesn't look like
he's
a superhero.
A kid,
he's just
yeah.
a kid. So if you ever unmask, it's like, you?
Yeah,
no, there's
yeah.
no there's no way that
right.
it could be, you know. I like it because at least... For me, like, Marvel can't, they can literally put whatever out at this point.
Right.
You know, like, when they put out Guardians, and I had no idea what Guardians was.
Yeah, yeah.
And
most
then,
people were.
And the way it resonated with me, or, like, Ant-Man, not necessarily a big fan. Like, I read,
yeah.
like,
it's okay.
I thought the Ultimates run was great. Like, him, how they portrayed him, because they portrayed him as such a piece of shit, you know,
right,
literally,
yeah.
you know, to where you get Cap having to take him out, you know. But the movie sense, like, Marvel's just doing such great work. Like, I just can't wait. Like, Civil War, it's feel like they, and they, now their trailers are basically like, we started with this movie.
Yeah.
Just to get to, this is, it's all been building to this. And
yeah.
it's just like a great time to
Doctor
be.
Doctor Strange, man.
Yeah, Doctor Strange.
Personal
is
favorite.
Okay, okay.
Doctor Strange, yeah. But, you know, it's crazy to think that, like, you know, 2005 was Iron Man, something like that, like 10 years ago, 11 years ago, whatever it was,
yeah.
that, you know, they're like, we're going to make an Iron Man movie.
Yeah.
Nobody cares about Iron
Man. No one cares. I think the only reason I went to see it is because Robert Downey Jr. was in it.
Yeah,
like, I
yeah.
would,
That's interesting.
That, less than zero. That guy's a train wreck. Let's see how good it can be, and then just mind blown. Yeah.
I would still say it's probably my favorite comic book movie.
Okay.
I think it holds up above everybody else. It's just like being original at the time, and just like, man, it was so good. I can watch it
An origin story standpoint, the origin story didn't feel forced. Like, I think that's kind of one of the big...
How do you pull realism into it?
Yeah, you know, just the idea of truly like a character arc, like the way he starts out, that first scene to what he became, and by the time he says, I'm Iron Man, you went, oh my God, like the journey had really worked on so many levels. Right. Like, I was... But what's next for this guy?
Yeah. He's still conceited. He's like, it's not my bodyguard.
He didn't pull like a Bruce Wayne and be like, no, I don't know who.
Right,
the Bat Vigilante? I have no idea who this Bat person needs to be. I can still watch Captain America, like the first Avenger, and be blown away. Like, there's just...
Winter Soldier was...
Yeah, that was one of those that I wasn't sure if I was going to catch. Like, it took me a bit. I wasn't as enthralled with it. You know, like, Ant-Man, I waited until it showed up on Stars. But I remember Cap, man. I really wanted to see that one. Thor, because of who the director was. But just to think of the scope, like, Special Olympics Gardens came out, that there's this huge other world. Or the fact, like, in Avengers, they have the money shot of all of them, like, you know, the circular shot where they're all, like, ready to take on whoever. Or the scene in Avengers, like, Age of Ultron, where they have them slow-mo jumping into action,
I've always wondered, like, why is this connection between wrestling and comic books, like, so, like, it's just almost concrete. Like, it's almost universal. Like, every wrestler is like, yeah, comic books are amazing, you know?
Yeah.
For me, like, Winter Soldier... I was like, the idea of, like, oh, it's his friend who lost his arm, now he's a Russian spy. Like, that is amazing.
Yeah.
It's like, that's wrestling, you know? Like, these crazy characters, like, over the top of, like, you know, you have, like, and, like, a comic is, like, 15 pages, right?
Yeah.
Like, we have 15 pages to tell this story. Like, well, we have this match to tell this story between these two crazy characters. Yeah. We gotta get it over, you know? So,
yeah.
I think it's, like, really cool correlation.
I've always likened it to just the idea of kind of having, secret identity to some degree, like who you are, who you portray in front of the camera is definitely not what you necessarily take home all the time. And that some people live it or, you know, become it, be engulfed by it, but or at the same time, like, have a regular job and like, no, I don't know what you're, you know.
Yeah, I gotta work with a black guy. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, don't worry about it.
Yeah, yeah. Like, well, I work at a law firm, and I probably for the first maybe year and a half, no one knew, except for my boss, because I'd be like, well, I have to go to a wrestling show,
Isn't that the most professional thing?
No, I know, it's just, someone found out, like a secretary found out I was at a trial, and she told all the attorneys, and then I was like, she's like, yeah, I typed in your wrestler name, and all the stuff on YouTube came out, and luckily for me, it was like me versus Sabu, so at that point, I walked in the room and they had just seen that, so I got like a sexy Steve chant, which was great. But then at the same time, they're like, "I would not mess with you because you throw chairs." I'm like, "Don't ask me about your
pay again
next time."
I will hit you.
What's the future as far as like? Are you looking? I know reality wrestling's all our goal is to build it. And before I continue, like, what are your thoughts of the building?
I think it's great. I think we just have to establish ourselves in the community, and like, it's something we're all working very hard to do.
Yeah.
But man, you know, every show, our crowds are very entertained, man. Like, you know, they're the loudest crowds that I can remember us having.
Mm-hmm.
And I think our shows are the best they've ever been. I think it's the professionalism of the venue, the product that we're putting out. I think it's just a matter of time. We're just gonna keep growing.
So this will air. After WrestleFest, Texas City WrestleFest, and you guys, you and Brian are kind of the headliner, right? The headliner. How much pressure do you feel because it is a, you know, it's a further like trying to extend our brand to an extent, probably a whole new audience, or, you know, probably have some people that know who we are, but it is going to be like a new audience. How you feeling for that?
You know, I haven't considered like pressure.
You know, now that you mention it, it's kind of crippling.
Kind of weighing on me.
Oh man, I don't know if I'm going to get up. Let me call book now. Yeah. I don't know if I can do it. No, I'm just kidding.
No, I don't really feel any kind of pressure, man. You know, it's just do your thing, right? Perform. Mm-hmm. Like if I always felt like if you can't perform under pressure, you're no good to anybody.
Yeah.
Because there's going to be pressure if you're going to succeed. Like you're going to, if you want to be the main event, like you're going to have to be the main event. Like you might as well just understand that it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Why be scared of the inevitable, I guess.
Yeah. Know?
And, my goal is to just be the best I can be and perform at the best level I can. So it's, you know, an inevitability, you know. And I know I got a fantastic opponent in Brian.
Yeah.
And just with what we're coming in with, story's going to be easy.
It's it is definitely, I mean, breaking his arm and and then him coming back and
totally couldn't hold his baby.
I mean, if you, like, yeah. But it's true. He's gonna need a little help with
poor
it.
Brian's amazing talent, man. I have 100% respect for him. I think he was, as far as the character and as far as kind of having like the whole package, I think he was way ahead of most guys on the show.
I mean, once he got. It's one of those things, like, once he got the bounty hunter thing bestowed, you know, kind of like,
right.
This is what you're going to be, or you got to change your look, we can't have you be, I think he just embraced it. It didn't hurt the crowd and his success level, like, kind of, you know, he was on the rise at that point. I think Gino, kind of the same thing, like a kid who, you know, for all intents and purposes, a kid, man, starting out so young and now being kind of the face of the company. But another guy, like, be Gino, and it's like, wow, it kind of fits. Or Marcellus Black, who debuts first match ever, and I'm blown away by, like, the only thing I think I told him afterwards was like, well, in the entrance, I could have had a beat here, a pause here, but outside of that, I can't say anything.
I remember I was blown away by
Yeah,
it.
Man.
It's so interesting when you just see, like, you have all the pieces, and then, you know, we just got to put it all together. We got to figure out what that final piece is to, and then once you get that, you just gotta like mold it more, right?
Yeah.
You got to fix it up.
Yeah.
I think, like, so many guys, like Ryan, is falling into, like, his groove, and just kind of, like, it seems like everyone's just kind of, like, we finally have that thing of, like, this is a show in which these are the characters. Like, we have the established characters.
Yeah.
It's great, man. It's great.
Well, like, even the, Gustavo were talking about the women as of late. I think, no disrespect to what we had, you know, what the Diamonds division was before. I think Ivory was a phenomenal champion,
absolutely.
You know, and as far as, like, helping kind of reestablish at a time. I know I'm going to have her on my show at some point, and I know it's going to be the, what was it like when the division wasn't there and you were still, like, here every week, you know, you're here constantly at practice, you're here at every show, this, that, and the other.
Like a self-fulfilling thing, like, girls would come, like, there's no girls, and the girls would leave.
Yeah.
It's like constantly, we build a division like this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But to see Kylie Rae, like, what she's been able to do the last couple of matches, just, like, her and Jada, like, everyone's just stepped up their game tremendously.
Yeah. I don't know, it just seems like everything. Not just reality wrestling. Everything in wrestling is just kind of like just lifted, and I don't know what it is.
I think there's for me, it what I see now that's so different from before is just with social media, the idea that if you're not one of those companies putting out footage on a regular basis, no matter how often you run. You're just kind of the exception as opposed to the rule. The rule now is if have a YouTube channel or have some way of getting your product out, like, and it can't be just DVDs. It's got to be.
No one's buying DVDs.
Yes. you know, now you put it online and you pay for that, or you know, you put it on YouTube and you get some kind of. But yeah, I think it's just this idea that anything's achievable.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, young talent now. WWE was probably next to impossible. Not saying that the competition level, if anything, it's increased because now they bring in everyone.
Right. What about before? Was like, if you're 27, you're done. That's
yeah.
Like, you don't have a chance.
Yeah, no, they would be like, oh man, you're 30?
Yeah.
God, what did you
wrap it up?
What were you thinking?
Why are you wearing boots?
What's going
on?
Go to the back.
Ice your back.
I would get that a lot. I would get that like, oh man,
that's unfortunate.
Yeah, it's like, thanks, 30. Guys. Yeah, I'm like, guys, I'm only 35. Like when I said, DDP's not even had his first match.
Like,
yeah,
well, I'm fine.
I'm fine. Yeah. Oh, I can't miss that. Yeah,
wow.
It's a little.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense of just like, and you know, within our, just talking to guys, I've heard people say like, you know, oh, we got to get out there, got to hit the road, get it. Like, yeah, that's fine if you want to do that. Man, the opportunity's right here. Like, if you want to.
Well, let me ask you about that because the last time we spoke, there was that exclusivity thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And for me, as I mentioned that, I'll mention it now, that it would not have changed my mindset whatsoever. I was kind of ready, to just take a break.
Yeah, yeah.
Physically, just to
right.
not have to do it. Just to recharge. But at the same time, like, what I found is anywhere else, even though some people would say it would be more fun, I needed the accountability of someone.
Yeah.
Like, not necessarily have to being Booker.
Right.
But the fact that, why would you go somewhere else where you're not even given, like, some kind of advice of what to improve on?
Yeah, yeah.
Or you ask, like, how was it? And someone tells you, oh, it was solid, but they can't give you anything else.
Yeah.
Whereas with Book, it's...
Or you get, like, the good match, man. Like, did you see it?
No, man. Kind of.
Didn't you do like
a thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are the best. Oh,
yeah.
But you liked it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Appreciate that.
But I do hear, there are a certain, school of thought of go wrestle everywhere. When you're young, it's like get as much experience as you can.
Right. I think it's got to be for the right reason, though, right? Like,
yeah.
Some guys are like, I just want to go wrestle. I just want to get out. And like, okay, cool. But what are you improving on? Why are you doing this?
Yeah.
And if you're not working with guys who can help you tell a story, or like you're just wasting your time. You know what I mean? Like, you gotta be doing. It's art, right? You have to be working with an artist. You can't be just working some kind of like There's guys who don't take it as seriously, who don't look as deeply into it as they should, or like don't try to tell a story, right? This one you do moves. This one you do cool stuff.
Or it's just, again, for me, it's always like accountability. Like, I don't, it even can affect talent that normally work at Books, and then they go other places,
right.
And, like, they don't have that.
Freedom. Oh.
They're like, oh, freedom, and I'm like, that doesn't, no, man. Like, for me, it's like, anytime I'm out there, I want people to be, I want to be proud of what's out there.
Absolutely.
And if it's not the best quality, well, then I don't want to be a part of it. Or if it's, the crowd's really small, and, well, then I don't want to be seen there,
And this, that's hard, right? Because you never know. That's not up to you.
Yeah.
I think if you look at it like the way a musician would, right? The musician isn't like, oh, we're playing, some small town tonight. Oh, we're just gonna find it.
Yeah.
Like, you're never gonna like that musician again.
Yeah.
You're gonna love those people. Like, I'm watching on reality wrestling, man, you're so great. And then I went and saw you live, and you suck.
Yeah.
I'm never watching you again. I don't care anymore.
Yeah.
I mean? Like, and how are you improving yourself, right?
Yeah.
Like, I think. If you're wrestling, you should be working to entertain the people as much as possible and just trying to better yourself, And I'd be happy to wrestle in places if the opportunity comes up. But I definitely want it to be something where I'm accountable, something reputable, something where I'm going to grow and have an opportunity to just get reps in, right?
Yeah.
That opportunity to practice. At Booker's, the eyes are on us, and the better we get, the more we work. More eyes are going to be on us,
Yeah.
And I think a lot of guys take for granted that power of like having a well-produced show and being a part of that.
Yeah. Well, because it's interesting because I was talking to Gustavo and Ryan too, like the guys that were there when we were at the Commerce Building.
Yeah.
And I came from PCW, which was a full production, and like, for us it was like WWE. That's how I treated it, and I
our locker room was very protective of anyone who would come in, especially once I became a close to a top guy. Once I started kind of getting on the rise, like any newcomer, I wanted to know that they had the same respect. And luckily for me, people realized the what we were doing as a product.
Right.
So to see what it's become, and then to see that like we have new students that come in and have no idea like what it was like on Commerce, or what it was like when we were wrestling in Pasadena, or you know,
that's true.
Before the rebranding, even the people that came in, you know, when it was before PW, you know, when it was PWA, now that it's ROW, it's like, man, you have really no idea. Like the people in the new building, I go, and you really have no idea. Absolutely. Like this is the best, probably best thing out there, unless you. Even companies that are kind of making noise, like if it's not a Ring of Honor, I go, well, you're not, I mean, if you're not at that level of reality wrestling, like, I don't know, like, what would be the purpose, because I'm not getting as much exposure unless I'm in one of those products, or going to NXT where it's like,
which of course, you know, like if that opportunity comes up, go.
But like, even if I was actively wanting to wrestle and perform, you know, because there are times where I'm like, oh man, it'd be great to be out there and get it. At the same time, like, even if I was wanting to go elsewhere, like, I don't know, because I wouldn't feel like I was as important as I would feel it is. It's not as important as, like, working for a book or something like that.
That's true.
Again, because of the, whether I like to admit or not, I like the times when book would, you know, give me some, you know, give me in essence a lecture or something like that, just because I knew he saw something that I really didn't see, you know, at that point. And it would always be the littlest things that I'm like,
right,
it was not even seeing that. He's like, well, I saw it, and I'm like, oh man. So then next time, and I'd always hear, you know, after those lessons, I always hear his voice on things of like what will and what works. So.
And you know, it's a lot of guys first get started, they're a couple years in or whatever, like, book always contradicts himself. Like, no, he doesn't. It's situational. And it's all right. It's all situational.
Yeah.
You know, I'd be like, you know, guys get so frustrated. Like, I did the same thing last match. You said he liked it, and I did this match, they hated it. Well, you did it because you did it last match, as opposed to just letting whatever happen organically.
What's funny you say that. There was this guy, VIP and Samson, and they had they were going to be paired up. So Book wanted to see a match.
Yeah.
So one day they put on a match, and Book really enjoys it, loves it, tells him don't change a thing.
Yeah.
So the next day, they do the same match for, like, pretty much the same exact thing, exact pauses. Book was like, what are you doing? And guys would be like, what's going on? I'm like, well, he saw it.
Yeah,
he's already seen it. Like, even if he tells you not to change it, he doesn't want to see a repeat. You know, because I would do that. Like when I was first starting with him, I'd always kind of start my matches kind of the same. And he'd be like, "You do the same thing," and I'm like, "Well, but it's the same."
Yeah,
like change it up.
I'm not entertaining.
Yeah, I'm not entertaining. I was entertained before. Yeah. I'm entertained by you, but do something else. No, so.
Yeah.
So
I love The Simpsons. I'm tired of this episode.
I'd like to see how this story progresses. So man, I think reality wrestling's a magical place to some degree, because I think of all the people that are involved. Everybody kind of working towards a common goal, and seemingly feeling like there is that common goal. I can see it. I know people that've been there long enough. I'm sure you see it. Ryan see it. We all kind of see what the opportunity is, because we know what's out there.
Yeah.
You know, and in some respects, this is like a safe haven. So.
Right. Yeah. It is. It's man, we are so lucky to be part of this. And like, a couple times I've been like, if I wasn't here when this started, would they hire me? Do I deserve to be here? it's really cool, man. It's an awesome situation.
Yeah.
They were really lucky.
And man, I've been wanting to get you on the show, you know, in part because of India. I wanted to know like what had gone down there, you know, how you felt about that, and that the idea of how you've matured as you progressed, and being, I consider you one of the best guys out there, and in a locker room of great phenomenal talent. Like, yeah. You're doing something that no one else is doing, and I'm enjoying it, man. I'm a big fan.
That,
so,
yeah,
continued success, man.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me on.
Yeah, man.
Thanks very much, man.
Oh, no problem.